Elasticsearch, which is the core of the stack, and we are going to cover that in details today. And we have also a UI named Kibana, where you can visualize all the things that you have sent into Elasticsearch, and we are going to see a little bit of Kibana as well today. And there is an ingest layer built on two different products. One of them is Bits, and Bits are agents where you can collect information like logs, metrics, what is happening on the network card, for example, and stream all that into Elasticsearch, and then see that in Kibana, visualize all that in Kibana. And we have also a Logstash. So Logstash is an ETL where you can extract the information from a data source. It can be Bits information. It can be something else, like a SQL database, for example. You can transform to JSON document, enrich the document and the event themselves, and stream the result to whatever destination you want, like Elasticsearch itself, if you wish. So this is an ETL. So all that is the Elastic stack. Today, what I'm going to show you, I'm going to share all the information that I mentioned on my Twitter account, which is here, Dadune. So if you want to follow me, just follow this account. And today, I'm going to start from an existing GitHub repository, which is this one. So this repository is about a legacy application which deals with a person. And I'm going to show you that in a moment. So if you want to understand what I'm going to do during the session, you can go through all the different branches that you have here on GitHub. The last branch that we are going to end with, hopefully, is this one. And if you compare one branch to another, you will see all the steps that I'm performing live during the session. So you can check out this code if you wish. So the application that I have is about person, so person entities, and I'm going to show you the beans that I have. So this is a Java application. I have a Java bean for person where I have a name, a date of birth, a gender, some marketing data, and an address. And if you look at the address, you have the country and the city, for example, and also geopoints here. And now I'm using Spring Data and Hibernate behind the scene, and the schema in MySQL is automatically generated like this. So you have here, for the person bean, you have a person table. For the address and geopoint, you have an address table. And for the marketing data, you have a marketing table as well. So those are the information that I have. So the first thing I'm going to do is, so the use case is about search, obviously. And if I'm searching for anything in the database, for now I have nothing because I did not index anything yet in the database. So for that, I have this injector, and this injector is going to randomly generate person, and those persons are going to be stored in the MySQL database. So this is what is happening here behind the scene. And if I'm searching now, I can see that I have several number of people who are stored in the database, and I can start searching for name, for example, for Joe. I can search for Joe, what have you. And I have also another use case, which is name is the advanced search, where I can specifically search in specific columns, like the name column, the country column, or the city column. So if I'm searching for Joe, living in France, living in Paris, this is the result that I have here. So those are the two use cases that I have. If I'm showing you a bit the code here, anytime I'm saving a person bean here, I'm calling this service layer with this save method. And this save method is using a person repository, which is provided by Spring Data here. And this repository is going to basically save my entity into the three tables that I shown before. About the search itself, when I'm searching for something, so this is the search like Google method that I have. When I'm searching for something that the user has entered, I'm getting back from the interface this queue value. And if the user did not enter anything, then I'm running a find all query, which means give me everything that you have. Otherwise, if you have a parameter, then I'm using this find like Google method. And if we look into this method, this is a simple select from the person table and all the joins that are needed behind the scene, where I'm searching for whatever the user has entered in the name field, in the address.country, and in the address.city fields. So for the same content here. So this is what is happening behind the scene. If I look at the advanced search, this is kind of similar. I'm coming from the interface with three values. So the content for the name field within the form, the content for the country field, and the content for the city field. And then if I have anything set, I'm building an example and I'm using all the default find all method, which is provided by Spring Data here project. So basically this is what I have. If we play a bit with our data set, I told you that I can search for the name here. So Joe Smith, this is working very well. If I'm searching for Smith, Joe, it does not work. So why it does not work? Because my implementation is super naive here. If I want it to make it work, I should split at the space Smith and Joe and try to combine two different queries to make sure that I can find for Joe or Smith or both. So I have something probably to modify. I told you that I can search for, if I make a typo, it does not work. So maybe this is something that can be fixed as well in the SQL query. But we will see in a moment that we can fix also that with a proper search engine. I told you that I can search within the city field, like Paris. I can search also within the country field. But here, I do have something which is weird to me. If you look at the result set, the second person in the list is living in Italy. But this is correct because I'm searching within the name field, the country, and the city field. I can see here that France is actually part of on the name field. So that's correct. But what looks super wrong to me is the position of this entity. Here we are on the second position, and I would expect it to be on the first position. Why this? Because France, as a country, is not super. It's something which is happening super often, but France, within the name, is a super rare combination of terms. So I would expect to have France Gall on the top of the list and not on the second position. Here I'm lucky because France Gall is the second person I have injected in my database, and there is absolutely no relevancy here. So what I would like to have now is to transform and fix all the problems that I have seen, have more relevancy if possible, and try to deal with typos, try to deal with terms which can be inverted. So to do that, I want to use a proper search engine, and obviously the best search engine ever is Elasticsearch, but I'm biased because I have been working for Elastic for a long time now. So don't trust me, try everything by yourself and you will see if everything that I'm telling is actually true. And this is true, I can tell you. So now the question is how you can send the data to the database. And that's exactly all the process I came through when I was working for the French custom. The first idea I had was to use an ETL. It could be Talend, it could be MuleSB, it could be Logstash, obviously. But what are the problems that I found when you are using an ETL? When you are using an ETL, you have to run like a batch every 5 minutes and get all the entities that you can have and send that to Elasticsearch. But what is happening from the end user point of view? When you save a new entity in the application, and search immediately for it, it's not available yet. You can have to wait up to 5 minutes before the batch is running and take your new entity into account. So it's not real time, and this is one of the main issues that I have seen. The second problem is every 5 minutes, what are you doing? Are you collecting all the data again and again and again? Or are you, do you want to just index the updates only, what have been modified? If you want to do that, it means that you need to add a technical field in your table, which is the last modify date for your entity. So to me, it's not ideal, but it's easily fixable because you can just add a new field, but you have to deal with this field. What about deletes? When you want to remove something in the database, you want to make sure that this thing that you have removed is also removed the next time the batch is running. So it's tricky because there is an information that you don't have anymore because you remove the data, and you need to be aware that this information that does not come anymore has to be removed in Elasticsearch. So it's a tricky problem, in my opinion. You can solve that maybe with a trigger, or maybe you can have also a technical table with all the deletes that you need. But to me, it's far from being ideal. So I ended up modifying the application service layer. And if you have access to your application and to your code, this is what I would totally encourage you to do. So modify the application service layer and send the data to Elasticsearch in the same transaction, in the same time that you are sending the data to the database. And this is exactly what I'm going to do now. So the first thing to do is to obviously add Elasticsearch to our project. So in my POM here, I'm going to add the dependency for Elasticsearch here. So I'm using the latest version that we released two days ago, I think. So I hope that everything will be okay. So I'm basically using here this REST high-level client. And this is coming with other dependencies that I'm specifying here. What I said is that within the person service here, anytime I'm saving an entity in the repository, I want to save the same entity inside Elasticsearch. So I'm going to create a new class named Elasticsearch DAO, and I'm going to save this PersonDB entity. By the way, I hope that everybody is able to see my screen. Yeah. If you can confirm in the chat, that will be super useful. So I need to create this class here. So let's build a new final. Yes, thank you. Elasticsearch DAO class. I'm going to add this class in the DAO package. Here, yes, and I'm using Spring Boot, so I can annotate that with a component annotation, and then I can just add this to the constructor and inject this here in my person service layer. Now I can implement the save method, so I need to add here and save my person. So the first thing I need to do is to provide actually Elasticsearch client. So let's add this here, private, final. So I have this REST high-level client class, which is available. And let's build this in the constructor. So I'm going to remove that. Demo. Client. Okay, so here, this is the way you can build a client. If you want to run the same demo that I'm running today, you can, there is a Docker Compose specification in the repository that you can just run and start. So it will run Elasticsearch locally behind this HTTP REST endpoint. And it will run with a default username and change me as the password. Here, I don't want to run everything locally. So I'm going to use Elastic Cloud instead, where I have everything running already. So here, if you go to your Elastic, to your cloud.elastic.co webpage, you have, by the way, 14 days for free without any credit card if you want to test that. I have already deployed a cluster here, so you can have multiple clusters. And here, I have my Elasticsearch endpoint, which is available. So I'm going to copy this endpoint. I have also Kibana, which has been deployed. And the endpoint I'm going to use now is this one. And instead of using Elastic and ChangeMe, I'm going to use legacy as the username and the password. Okay, so with this, normally I do have a client available for run. So what I want to make to check is that actually everything is working well. So I'm going to call a simple method. The name is info to make sure that I'm connected to the cluster with default options. And this can send an exception. And this gives me info response, why not? And what I can do now is to log. So I need a logger. Let's add the logger here. Which one? Yes, this one. And so let's log some information to make sure that we are rightly connected. So let's say that we are connected to this cluster, which is running version blah. So the cluster is the cluster URL. And to get the version, I can use this info object, get the version, get the number. And that should be good, I think. OK. So the first thing we can do is to maybe to restart now and check that everything is OK. So let's restart that. So we should see in the trace, hopefully, that we are connected. So yes, here we can see that we are connected to the cluster, and the cluster is running 7.9.3. So everything is OK. So now we can start to implement this save method that we need. So what can we do to implement that? So what do we need? To communicate with Elasticsearch, we need to send a JSON document to Elasticsearch. So to send JSON document, we need to serialize the person bins to JSON content. For that, there is this super nice project named Jackson, which is available in the Java world. So here we can use the object mapper class provided by Jackson. And this will help us to serialize and deserialize the data that we have. So let's inject that in the constructor here. So we can now use here the mapper and write the person bin as a JSON document. So this is basically what is done here. So let's throw an exception. So this is the JSON representation of my person bin. And then the second command that we can send, we can call the Elasticsearch client and call the index method, where I want to index a document. So I'm going to build an index request. And one of the questions that the index request is asking me is the index name. So let's create and let's send our document in an index name person. An index is like a schema in the MySQL world. Then I need to add the options here. Yeah. The second thing I need to provide is the ID. So I can provide the ID. I'm not forced to provide the ID, but this is something that I would encourage you to do. Why this? Because The ID here is generated on the database side. And if I have any difference between the search engine and the database, it's super easy then to have the same naming convention, like an ID in the database has the same ID in Elasticsearch. So I'm using here the same ID for both. If you don't define an ID, then Elasticsearch is going to generate automatically an ID for you. And then I need to provide the source. So the source is the JSON document itself. And I'm going to tell Elasticsearch that this is a JSON content that I'm sending here. So basically, with those two lines of code, I'm able to write an entity to Elasticsearch. So this is basically easy to do. So let's compile that and see how it goes. So I can have an exception here. When I'm saving my entity to Elasticsearch, maybe Elasticsearch is not available or there is something wrong. So this is something you have to deal with this implementation. And one of the ideas you can have is to say, okay, if I have anything wrong with my Elasticsearch instance, then I can simply throw the exception and make the repository roll back everything. But when I was working for the French customs, it was super obvious to me that anytime my user is clicking on the save button in my application, I want it to be saved in the database if it's possible. I don't care about the search engine. If there is anything wrong with the search engine, then I can simply maybe log that information. Why not? Instead of rolling back the transaction. And that way I can persist my information into the database, whatever is happening with the search engine. A problem. That's the right message to send with the exception. What I did actually was not only logging that we have an issue, but I was sending the entity, which has a problem, to a message queue system. And anytime my Elasticsearch instance was back to life, I was looking at the message queue system and sending all the entities that I have not been sent already. So that was a way for me to deal with issues in Elasticsearch itself. So I mentioned that. I mentioned also that when you want to delete an entity in the database, you want it to be deleted in Elasticsearch itself as well. So let's do the same implementation here. In the delete method, I'm going to call my Elasticsearch DAO, and I'm going to add a new method where I want to delete an entity knowing its ID. So let's create this method. Again, going to call the client with a delete request. Oops, new delete request. And what I need to provide here is the index name and the ID. So the index name is person, and the ID as a string is this one. I need to provide some option, default options here, and send an exception. So normally I would expect to have everything working. So I'm going to restart the application. We run. And while this is starting, I'm going to open Kibana. So let's open Kibana. So Kibana is automatically deployed for you when you start a cluster in Elastic Cloud. And here I'm going to use the dev tools, and the dev tool is super handy when you want to run query again the Elasticsearch cluster instead of using a curl requests, which are a bit painful to write. So here I can do a simple get slash, and within this get slash I can get this number. So this is basically the same thing that I did when I called the info method. I was getting back that kind of information. What I want to show you is that I don't have any index and any data yet in the person index. So nothing is available here. So when I'm going to send again, let's say 1,000 documents, Normally, those documents are going to be sent both in the MySQL database and in Elasticsearch. Look at this rate. For now, calling only MySQL, we have this number of person per second that we have been able to insert. Here, I'm expecting it to be a bit slower. So yes, we are reducing a bit the ingest rate. Let's have a look at DevTools and call this query again. So we can see that we have that number of documents that have been sent to Elasticsearch already. If we run a simple search to get back those documents, yeah, so this is typically a search query. So I have that number of documents which has been indexed so far. And this is a JSON representation of the document. So we can see that we have all the information that we need here, the name, date of birth, the gender, and et cetera, et cetera, the country and the city. So apparently, everything is working well. But for our application, if I'm searching here again, here, I'm searching within the database. I did not change yet the way we are searching. So we are searching using the database. So the next step is to search within Elasticsearch now. So let's do that. So I can see that I have a question. So what if transaction fails after ES client is invoked, DAO will roll back, but ES client won't. Exactly, there is no transaction in Elasticsearch itself. So this is something you have to deal by yourself. If you are using a project like Hibernate Search, I know that they did something super smart with that, with the connection with Elasticsearch, and they are able to basically minimize this. What I have been doing in the past, I was tracking and running every night a comparison between the database and the search engine to make sure that there is no difference. And if there was a difference, I was rebuilding either entirely the Elasticsearch or a subset of the of what was missing in Elasticsearch itself. So you have to manually deal with that. So let's change now the search part. So as I said, we don't want to use anymore the search implementation that we had before. So instead of that, we are going to call Elasticsearch. So we are going to use some classes that are provided by Elasticsearch. So the query builder is one of them. And we want to build a query here. What I'm going to say is that if there is nothing entered by the user, as we did previously, the query I want to use is what we call a match all query. So this one, which means give me everything back. Otherwise, if the user has entered something, the query I want to use is a multi-match query. Here, I can provide what the user is searching for, so Q. And I can provide the fields I want to search in. So I want to search within the name field. We said address.country and address.city. That was the field that we were searching for previously. Everything is indexed with Elasticsearch, so I can also search in the gender field if I wish. So let's do that. Then I want to call my Elasticsearch DAO, and I want to implement a search method where I'm going to provide a query, and I'm going to show you as well how you can deal with pagination with the from and size parameter, which are coming from the interface. So let's create this method here. And the implementation is kind of easy. I'm going to call the search method with a new search request. And here I can define in which index I want to search. So Elasticsearch is a multi-tenant. And you can search across multiple indices. Here, I just want to search within the person index, and that's all. and I can have my options. This can send an exception. So I need to provide now the query and the other parameters. So I'm going to build a new search source builder. It's a bit verbose, but still. So what is the query? The query is the query that we created before. And for the from and size parameter, it's super straightforward. You have a from and size method. So size is the size of the page, and from is from which entity you want to start from. And so basically with that, it should be okay. So now I can get back my response object and return this response object to the caller. Okay. In the person service, I can get back this response object. And here, the purpose of the talk is about the backend, not the frontend. So everything is already available in the frontend. So I can just send my my response object as a JSON document, and everything will work automatically. My application is not that legacy, actually. I forgot to do something. Here I forgot a parameter, which is track total hits. So this is if you don't specify this, there is an optimization to make the search being faster. If here, because I know that I'm going to inject more than 10,000 hits, I want to have the exact number of hits after 10,000. So I'm going to add this feature, which is going to slow down a bit my request, but that's okay. You will see that it's not that bad probably. So I'm done with the simple search here. Let's do the same thing with the advanced search. I'm going to remove all that code and instead going to build the advanced search. Obviously, I'm not going to write the code myself. Here I am, I'm cheating a bit. So what I'm telling is that when I'm coming from the interface with the name, country, and city fields within the form, if I have nothing in those fields, then run a matchall query. That's what we have seen before. Otherwise, I'm going to build a Boolean query. And if I have anything coming from the interface within the name field, then it must match on the name field within the documents. If I have anything coming from the for the country, it must match on the address on country field, and same for address.city. And then I'm calling the same DAO that we have seen before. So let's restart the application and see how it goes. Okay. So the application is running here. So if I'm searching for nothing, you can see that I have here my match all query, which is running. And if I'm searching for Joe, it does not work. Oh, it works only if I have the full term, apparently. So Joe works, but GO does not work. So this is something we need to fix just after. If I'm searching for Smith, Joe. So now Smith Joe is working well. So whatever the order of the terms, I have something which is working well. So this is very good. I can search for the city if I'm using the full term. I can search also for France. And have a look here. France Gall is now on the top of the list, which is super good here. And why this? This is because we are by default, we are sorting the result set and we are ordering the result set by the score that we computed at search time. And the higher the score is, the more relevant the document is. And here, how all that is computed, you can see that I have exactly the same score for all the countries here. But when I have France in the name, it's much more relevant for Elasticsearch. And why this? Because France within the name is more unique than France within the country. That's how relevancy is working by default. We will see that we can modify a bit these relevancy factors. In a moment, there is a lot of options that you have, but we will see one of those options later. Have a look at the advanced search now. If I'm searching for Joe, so it only works with the full term, France, Paris. So it works not exactly as it was working previously, but there is something running actually. And by the way, I can search for the gender field, as I said, also. So it looks more or less good. We have two things to fix. The fact that I cannot search part of the term, and also that rate, because we have slowed down the ingestion rate in our application, we want to fix that. So let's fix that first. To fix that, what we need to do is to understand what is happening in Elasticsearch in the client. So here, anytime I'm calling this method, esclient.index, I'm actually opening an HTTP request to Elasticsearch, sending the JSON document, and then getting back the response. So for every single document, I have to do that. And this is not the ideal way for doing that. Instead, you should use what we call the bulk API. And in Java, we have a very nice class, a helper, named the bulk processor, which is super helpful to deal with the bulk API. So I'm going to explain exactly what I'm going to do here. So let's add this bulk processor. So the bulk processor here I'm building it with some options. I'm going to send actions to the bulk processor. And what I'm telling here is that every 10,000 actions, you are going to flush the bulk processor and call the bulk API with 10,000 actions at the same time. So send 10,000 actions per 10,000. The other parameter I'm using here, which is also useful in my opinion, is the flush interval. It means that even though you don't have 10,000 elements in your bulk, every 5 seconds, flush what you have into Elasticsearch. So this is basically what is going to happen behind the scene. And here, I'm going to use now this bulk processor. And instead of calling the esclient.index method, I'm going to use the bulk processor and add the index request. And I don't need any options now. Here, so I'm going to add the index request that we have seen before to the bulk processor. And I can do the same thing for the delete method. I can add the delete request to the bulk processor as well. So let's restart the application again. I'm not going to inject new documents yet. I'm going to fix the second problem that we have first, and then we will see what is happening. So when I'm searching for GO like this, it does not work, but with the full term, it works. Why this? We need to understand that with Elasticsearch, there is a schema, and the schema is automatically generated by Elasticsearch by default. So we can see the schema here by calling this endpoint. And what we can see here, that this mapping has been automatically generated for us. And if we look, for example, at the name field, what we are saying here, we are telling Elasticsearch that with the name field, we want to do full text search on it. So this is of type text. This is the reason we have this type text. But we are not specifying any options. And by default, what is happening behind the scene when we index a document in Elasticsearch, it do some text transformation to generate tokens. And those tokens are then indexed in the inverted index. To see that in action, there is this super nice underscore analyze API, which is available. And when you provide a text like Joe Smith, like this one, With the default standard analyzer that Elasticsearch is using behind the scene, you can see the tokens that are generated by Elasticsearch and then indexed inside Elasticsearch itself in the inverted index. So here are the two tokens that I have are Joe and Smith. And when you want to search for GO, you are going to use the same analyzer as we have seen before. So Joe here, lowercase, does not match the Joe uppercase here. Sorry, the Joe GO does not match the GOE that we have in the inverted index. But GOE here works well. So to change that, we need to change the way we are indexing our data set. I'm going to use a specific here settings. So I'm going to use what we call n-gram tokenizer, and this n-gram tokenizer is going to basically, instead of generating GOE at index time, it's going to generate G, GO, GOE. So three terms, and same for Smith. And I'm going to apply these settings to my mapping here. So here for the name field, I'm going to, by default, use the type text for the name field. But at index time, I'm going also to generate a field name name.ngram, which is a type of text and which is going to use the strategy that we have seen before. I done that already. So I also changed a few things here, like I'm going to use also a keyword subfield for some fields where I can do aggregations and sorting. So let's continue. Sadly, I'm running out of time, so I'm not going to show you a lot of things. One of the things I want to show you is that when I index now, again, 1,000 documents, it's much faster than it was before. And if I'm searching for GO, it does not work. Why this? Because I'm still searching within the name field that we have seen before. So instead of searching within the name field, I'm going to search within the name.ngram field. And what I'm going to say as well, and same for country and city. And what I'm going to say is that if I'm matching on the name field, I'm going to boost the result by a factor of 3. So if I have exact match on the name field, then it's super important for my use case. So let's compile that. And see that if I'm searching now for G, O, E, we can see that it works very well now. If I'm searching for France, okay, so we can see that the boost factor here is super noticeable here. If I don't have the exact term, then I have a lower score for France guy. So I'm done for that. How many? So I have only 5 minutes left. So sadly, I won't be able to show you a lot of other things that I wanted to show you. One of the things I want to show you is that you can have here, you can deal with typos by just adding this fuzziness factor, fuzziness auto. And when you do that, if you are searching again within Elasticsearch and you are searching for France, for example, then it works well with the typos. Yes, I can show you advanced search again here. So here, if I'm searching for Joe, it does not work, but it will work if I search within the n-gram fields here, and this. So Joe living in France, living in Paris. So I do have my result set. Okay, so if you have any questions, please add them into the chat. Yes, so I have some questions yet. So when you say multi-tenancy, did you refer to different users querying information with different indexes using the same cluster? You can have different users in your cluster when you are using authentication, and then those users can query different indexes, but those users can also query all the indexes at once. So this is what I call multi-tenancy. It's like in your database, if you have multiple schema within the same database, and you are able to query all the schema within only one query. What is the impact of the bulk processor as in memory footprint foo? I assume this is a trade-off, ingestion time versus memory footprint. So it has an impact on the client side because you have to hold the 10,000 actions in memory before flushing them to Elasticsearch. So if you are a memory constraint, then you can just reduce that 10,000 bulk number of actions to something like 1,000 if you wish. So you have to test that. Yes, it depends on the batch size. Thank you. Would a prefix search be a valid alternative to ngram? Yes, you can do that, of course, but then it won't work with the first character, but that's okay. There is also a specific API named suggester and completion suggester, which can be also helpful to deal with typos. Thank you. What is the option to delete the old data from Elasticsearch database? So the option is the delete index. And basically, when you call this API, you are dropping the index named person. This is an immediate operation, and you are clean to start again. Is it possible to set access right on a single index record? Yes, but for that, you need to have a Platinum license. So all the information that I shown you today is available within the free basic version of Elasticsearch. But if you want to have that fine control of access rights for specific records or specific fields, then you need to have a Platinum license. Having only access to an index or not access to the index is available within the basic license, which is free. What if the bulk operation fails? How to sync the data again? So yes, we have listeners in the code for that. When you look at this, here there is a listener. And anytime there is a hard exception here, you can get that information. Or after the bulk, if there is exceptions for some records, then you can just track them here and look at the response itself and track for all the records which has exception. And then deal with that, maybe send them again to Elasticsearch or send that to a temporary message queue system or what have you. And I don't think yet I have other questions. So I'm just going to show you something while we are here. So when you are when you have indexed everything in Elasticsearch, you can build super nice visualization like a BI a thing. So I don't have inject much data here, but if I'm searching for my Joe people here, I can see the distribution of my Joe, and I can go within different and drill down actually to understand what my data set is built. And this is the result set that I have. So you can use that for whatever use case you have. So thank you all.